Could we talk just for a couple of minutes more generally about wetlands protection historically? Again, Clean Water Act was enacted in the 70s. You've been working in wetlands protection since the 80s at least, well, going back to the core before that. Could you tell us a little bit about what you think are some of the successes in wetlands protection and some of the areas where there's still work to be done in wetlands protection, having seen over time?
So I really do look to the Clean Water Act, the passage of the 1972 Clean Water Act, as being a huge success. Now, you know, as spending all these years since then trying to defend the Clean Water Act, and particularly in this Waters of the U.S. Rulemaking struggle, it's really interesting to me to look back and see how the concept behind the Clean Water Act, the concept of watershed concept, of in order to protect downstream navigable waters, that you have to stop pollution at its source. The understanding that all those little tributaries and headwaters and wetlands function together to filter and protect downstream aquatic fish and wildlife, but also drinking water and flood storage and the whole thing. I mean, the notion that that was embedded in the Clean Water Act and in the legislative history, and that there was the foresight to put in a provision on dredge and fill in order to protect wetlands for these values and functions, is pretty interesting now looking back as we're having to defend those basic principles in ever since the 2001 Swank decision and the 2006 Rapanos decision. Those basic scientific principles are being questioned by the court, and we're having to defend them, and they're standing up. They're standing up to that defense. So I think the 72 Act I see as a real success. In terms of areas that I think we really need to look to improving is now, so you have the Clean Water Act, you have this regulatory structure, and I think a lot of us from, certainly from my generation of lawyers and advocates, rely very heavily on these regulatory tools, TMDLs and water quality standards, and basically telling people you can't discharge that into this water. I think what we need to do now is kind of do more to leverage the science and the technology that's out there, the mapping tools in particular, to really kind of build on that base of regulatory action to broaden it to actually inform watershed plans that really engage people at the watershed level and build a broader wetland and stream protection effort that's not entirely top down, dependent on the Corps and the EPA and the state DEQ, but also can kind of begin to come down to that local level and have buy-in on both rural agricultural lands, but also in urban situations.